Hello children, today we will be taking up the first chapter in political science. The first chapter for you in 9th class is what is democracy, why democracy. All of us have heard this word democracy. India is the largest democratic country in the world. In your earlier classes you learned about the meaning of democracy, what are the key elements of democracy. In this lesson we try to understand what is the simple definition of democracy. Starting with the simple definition of democracy, why it is a popular form of government, we want to understand what are the features of democratic form of government. Few examples are given in your textbook. We have taken examples of countries like Pakistan, China, Mexico, Zimbabwe, so that we can arrive at the features of democracy. We also learn to differentiate democratic and non-democratic form of government by taking up these examples. And also, we also learn what are the arguments against democracy, what are the arguments in favor of democracy. And also, we arrive at the broader meaning of democracy. So, in your earlier class, you have learned that democracy has been derived from the Greek word demos and kratia. What does demos mean? It means people, and kratia means rule. Simply stated, democracy is a form of government which is ruled by the people. Now, what are the key elements of democracy? What you have learned? The key elements of democracy are, there is a political system for choosing or replacing the government through free and fair elections. How are the leaders elected? For example, let us take India. How are they elected? Through general elections. People cast their vote, and the party which gets the maximum number of votes, they form the ruling party. The party which loses form the opposition party. So, people are given this freedom to elect the leader to rule the country. Isn't it so, children? Now, there is active participation of the citizens, where in political life as well as in civic life. The other element of democracy is protection of human rights of all citizens. So we starting off with the simple definition of democracy, we see how this democracy functions. Okay, now from the last 100 years, for more than democracy has been expanding, children. More than half the independent countries are democratic in the world. But in this chapter, our focus will mainly be on what makes it, what makes democracy a better form of the government. Okay, now we will start off with what is democracy. See, all of you would have heard of the famous quote of Abraham Lincoln. Democracy is a form of government which is of the people, for the people and by the people. Who are involved mainly in this form of government? It is the people's involvement which is there. If you take a monarchical form of government, who rules? The king rules the entire country. Is he chosen by the people? He isn't chosen by the people. Why does he come to power? Why does he rule the country? It is because he happens to be born in a royal family. Here, people don't elect him. He rules because he is belonging to the royal family. For example, now also we have absolute monarchy in few countries. For example, if you take the case of Saudi Arabia, we have King Salman who is ruling, okay, who is an absolute monarch. Even in Nepal, a neighboring country, for 240 years they had absolute, they had monarchical form of government. Only in the year 2008, Nepal switched over to democratic form of government because people wanted democracy. Okay, today it has a president as the head of the state and the prime minister was running the government. So, in a monarchical form of government, the people don't elect the ruler. The ruler comes to power because he happens to be born in a royal family. Now, when we speak of democracy, when we start off with our definition, today let us start off our definition with what is this simple meaning of democracy. Simple meaning of democracy is that it is a form of government in which the rulers are elected by the people. Our focus will be on who are these rulers, how are they elected, who are these people. Okay, now there are a few questions. Let us see what are these. Okay, now I read out the definition of democracy. It's a form of government in which rulers are elected by the people. So if you look at page 26, The first question is, who are the rulers in this divination? Which officials must be elected for any government to be called a democracy? Who can contest election? Okay, even can an ordinary man contest elections? Okay, which decisions may be taken by non-officials, non-elected officials in a democracy? What kind of elections constitute a democratic election? What conditions must be fulfilled for an election to be considered democratic? What type of elections are there in the country? Are there free and fair elections? In these examples we get to know. Next, who are the people who can elect the rulers or get elected as rulers? Can everybody vote? Or is there a stipulation that you should have this equal political rights? Do all the countries have equal political rights? Some countries may be having, some may not be having. Then should this include every citizen on an equal basis? Can a democracy deny some of its rights, some citizens this right? Finally, what kind of a form of government is democracy? Can the elected rulers, when they come to power, can they do whatever they like? Or there are some limits which are set up by the constitution? Or must a democratic government function within some limits? Is it necessary for a democracy to respect some rights of the citizen? These are some of the aspects which we are going to discuss through this definition and through these examples. We will try to understand who the rulers are, how they are elected, how elections are carried out, and who are the people who are electing these leaders who run the government. Now, the first example, let us take this of Pakistan. So, what happened in Pakistan? In the year 1999, General Pervez Musharraf, he led a military coup. Now, what is meant by a coup is when a government is overthrown illegally, either through force, either through violence or non-violence, it is called as a coup. Now, at that time, Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, he was elected by the people to run the country. But what happened overnight? General Pervez Musharraf, he overthrew the democratically elected government and he declared himself as the chief executive of the country. We are speaking about which country, children? We are speaking of our neighboring country, Pakistan. What did General Pervez Musharraf do? He declared himself as the chief executive of the country by overthrowing the Prime Minister of that country. Later, he changed his designation to President, and in 2002, what did he do? He held a referendum in the country which granted him another 5 years of extension. People did not elect him, but he came to power by overthrowing this government. Now, the Pakistani media, the people who wanted democracy, the activists who were for democracy and the human rights organization, they said this referendum was based on malpractices and fraud. What is a referendum? When the government asks the people, okay, when a direct vote, General Pervez Musharraf wanted the people of Pakistan to say yes or no against his continuing as the president of Pakistan. Now, usually, you know, countries when they want opinion from the people, so they are asked to say yes or no, like suppose you have to amend the constitution or you have to adopt a new government policy, and this referendum is taken. So now what happened? Now these activists and media, now they allege that through malpractices and fraud, he was granted another 5 years extension. Now, what did he do when he took over? He issued a legal framework order. What is this legal framework order? Let us see. According to this order, at the time the constitution was provisionally suspended, he told that according to this order, he amended the constitution of Pakistan. Okay, according to this order, the president, what he can do? He can dismiss the national and provincial assemblies. Just like we have a central government where we elect members of the parliament. Now they also have a government at the center and at the state level. Now, by this amending the constitution, what did he do? He had the power to dismiss the national and provincial assemblies. Now, the work of the civilian cabinet is supervised by a National Security Council. And this National Security Council consisted of military officers. After passing the law, coordinate elections were conducted in Pakistan. Now, ministers were elected for the national and provincial assemblies. Now, Pakistan had elections, representatives were elected, but what happened? They had very limited powers. They could not use any power, though the power was given by the people. Now, who had the final power? Who had the final say in running the government? The final power rested with the military officers and with General Musharraf himself. Now, what do we say by looking into this example? What is it we can conclude? We can say that whether Pakistan under General Parvez Musharraf was a democratic form of government. Now, we can definitely tell that it was not a democratic form of government. The reason being, people, though they have elected representatives at the national and provincial level, they, what happened? These elected representatives were really not the rulers. Why? They cannot take any final decisions. The power to take final decision rested only with the army officials and with General Musharraf. And none of them were elected by the people. Now, what does the first feature of democracy say is the final decision-making power must rest with those elected by the people. In the case of Pakistan, he was not elected to power. Isn't it so, children? He overthrew the democratically elected government and he declared himself as the president. He had a referendum and he had an extension of another 5 years. So usually in monarchical and dictatorial form of government, though you have an elected parliament, the final power rested with some external force. Okay, now here the real power was with some external powers and not with the locally elected representatives. So what is the first feature is, in a democracy, the final decision-making power, we say democracy is a government which is chosen by the people. Isn't it so? When we say it is chosen by the people, the decision-making power must also rest with those elected by the people. Now let us take the second example of China. What happens here? Let us see. Now in China, elections are held regularly after every 5 years, just like how in India general elections are conducted every 5 years, even in China general elections are conducted. Now, the parliament is called as the National People's Congress. This National People's Congress had the power to appoint the president of the country. Now, it has nearly 3,000 members. How many members are there? This parliament consisted of 3,000 members who are elected all over from China. And some members, they are also elected by the army. Now, before contesting election, there is a clause. What is the clause? A candidate, he needs the approval of Chinese Communist Party. If he has the approval of this Chinese Communist Party, then only he can contest these elections. Now, only those who are members of the Chinese Communist Party or the eight smaller allied parties, they can contest in the elections. And the government which is formed is always by the Communist Party. There is only a single party. India has a multi-party system. People can vote for any party whom they like. Sometimes even independents also, they stand in the elections. So we have different political parties where people are given a fair choice of electing whichever political party they like. Now in China, this freedom wasn't there for the people. They did not have any opposition party. They were forced to vote only for one party, and that party which formed the power was the Communist Party of China. Now, let us look into the case study of Mexico. Now, what happens in Mexico? Let us see. Since independence in 1930, Mexico held elections after every 6 years to elect its president. The country has never been under a military or a dictator's rule. But until 2000, every election was won by a party called PRI. What is this PRI? It is the full form of PRI is Institutional Revolutionary Party. Institutional Revolutionary Party. Opposition parties were there. They also contested elections, but they never managed to win. Now again, let us compare with India. Since when India got its independence, Congress was in power. Later on, in between, you had Janata Dal, you had different parties which have come to power. Now at present, in the 2014 elections, you had the BJP coming to power. Again, the 2019 general elections, you had again BJP coming into power. So there is no one single party which keeps on ruling our government. So they can change according to the verdict given by the people. Now what happened in Mexico was, always only this party, which is that party? this PRI party, the Institutional Revolutionary Party, it won the elections. What is the reason behind that? Let us try to discuss. The PRI was known to use many dirty tricks to win the elections. They used malpractices to be in power. What did they do? All those who were employed in government offices, they had to attend its party meetings. They were forced to attend the party meetings, whether they liked or they did not like. And the teachers of the government schools, they were roping to use force. They used to force the parents to vote for the PRI party. Do you think, children, in the elections we can force somebody to vote for a particular party? It is not fair, isn't it, so children? You cannot use unfair means to win in an election. Now here what happened, teachers, they used to force the parents, you have to vote only for the PRI party. Media ignored the activities, the opposition political parties, except to criticize them. Sometimes what happened in the last moment, the polling booths were also shifted. Now it made it very difficult for the people to cast their vote. So, by hook or crook, the PRI party wanted to be in power. They never gave a chance for the opposition party to rule that country. So, can we call these elections as fair? So, now when we look into the second feature of democracy, in a democracy, you should have free and fair elections. People should be given the choice to elect which leader they want to be in power. This was missing in the case of China and Mexico. Though Mexico had opposition party, in practice it was only the ruling party which came into power. Okay, now let us look at this paragraph. He says there are many problems here. In China, elections do not offer a choice. Okay, they do not offer any serious choice. They have to choose only the ruling party. Which was the ruling party? The Communist Party. They have to always choose the Communist Party and the candidates approved by it. Can we call this really a choice for the people of China? In the Mexican example, people had a choice. They had the PRI party and then the opposition party. Though it was there, but when they practiced it, really they had no choice. So there was no way the ruling party could be defeated, even if the people were against it. These are not fair elections. So what can we conclude? We can say that the elections must offer a real choice between political alternatives. People should be given a choice as to which party they want to be in power. Okay. Now let us once again revise what is our first feature. The first feature says that the final decision making power must rest with those elected by the people. Secondly, you should have free and fair elections, where there should be every chance for the ruling party also to lose the elections. Okay, now let us look on to the third example of Zimbabwe. What happened? Before moving on to Zimbabwe, let us see one person, one vote and one value. We are all aware of universal adult franchise. So every country gives, most of the countries. Now this is an accepted example all over the world, where they give equal political rights. Political equality is the democracy is based on a fundamental principle of political equality. Okay, what does it say? In a democracy, each adult citizen must have one vote and each vote must have one value. For example, in India, all those citizens who have, every citizen of 18 years and above, they have the right to vote. Right, in the year 1950, we were given equal voting rights. Now, this principle has not come to be accepted all over the world. But there are few countries which have denied equal political rights to its citizens. Now, let us take the case of Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, women do not have the right to vote till the year 2015. Then, if you see Estonia, it has made its citizenship rules in such a way that people belonging to the Russian minority, they find it difficult to get the right to vote. They don't have equal voting rights. In Fiji, the electoral system is such that the vote of an indigenous Fiji has more value than that of an Indian Fijian. Whereas democracy, we speak that, democracy is based on the fundamental principle of political equality. People should have equal voting rights and each vote should have one value. Each and every citizen must have one vote and each vote must have one value. That principle is not applied to these countries. Now, let us look into the next example of Zimbabwe, where rule of law, we'll be speaking of rule of law and respect for rights. What happened in this country? Let us see. Now, Zimbabwe got its independence from the white minority rule in the year 1980. Where is Zimbabwe? It is a landlocked country in southern Africa. Now, its leader was Robert Mugabe. He belonged to the ZANU-PF party. What is the ZANU-PF party? What is this ZANU-PF party? This ZANU-PF party is a political organization which has been the ruling party since independence. What is it full for? Zimbabwe African National Union Patriotic Front. Now, Robert Mugabe, he has been ruling the country since independence, and this party led the freedom struggle in Zimbabwe. Now, elections have been held regularly and always won by this party, ZANU-PF. President Mugabe, though he is popular among the people, but what he did was he used unfair practices in the elections. Over the years, his government has changed the constitution several times to increase the powers of the president. In order to stay in power, what did he do? He kept on amending the constitution. Now, the opposition party, though opposition party was there, these party workers, they were harassed and their meetings were disrupted because always they wanted the say of the ruling party. Which was the ruling party in Zimbabwe? It was the ZANU-PF. Public protests and demonstrations against the government were declared illegal. People could not protest if they did not like the policies of the government. Okay, there is a law that limits the right to criticize the president. Now, television and radio, they were controlled by the government and they gave only the ruling party's version. Now, let us compare with India. Don't you think the opposition parties have the right to criticize the ruling party when some decisions go wrong? Everybody is given the freedom to voice their opinion in a democratic form of government. That opinion was denied in Zimbabwe. Now, independent newspapers, even though they were there, what they used to do? The government used to harass them if the journalists went against, reported against the ZANU-PF, against the ruling party. The government also ignored the court judgments that went against it, and it had pressurized the judges. In India, we have an independent judiciary, the Supreme Court of India. Whatever verdict it gives, that is the final and binding on the citizens of the country. Whereas even the judiciary also, what did the government do? It ignored the court decisions that went against it. Only which were in favor, they accepted it. Now, the example of Zimbabwe, what does it show? It showed that popular approval of the rulers is necessary in a democracy, but that alone is not sufficient. A leader may be popular, but he should not exercise his power as he likes. He cannot amend the constitution as he likes. He cannot be popular. Leaders can be autocratic also. If you wish to assess a democracy, it is important to look at the elections. Okay, but you know, there should be sufficient room for normal political activity. Every party should be given the freedom to express its views. They can put forward their policies and programs in front of the people and leave the choice to the citizen as to which party can come into power. That freedom should be exercised by the people. Why democracy is a better form of government? Because it is a people's government. It is a government chosen by the people. That particular the freedom should not be denied. So, we can say that this requires that the state should respect some of the basic rights of the citizen. They should be free to think. You should have the freedom to think. You should have the freedom to voice our opinion. Whether we like a particular policy or we don't like a particular policy. Okay, we can have debates, we can have discussions, we can consult different stakeholders who are affected by a particular policy decision. Then, you know, to form associations, to protest and take other political action. This freedom should not be denied. You should have the access. Everyone should be treated equally in the eyes of law. Okay, now these rights must be protected by an independent judiciary whose orders are to be obeyed by everyone. Now, there are some conditions that apply the way a government should run after the election. Suppose a particular ex-party has come into power. It has formed the government at the center. Now they cannot rule, that particular government cannot rule the way it likes. It has to follow certain basic rules. In particular, it has to respect some of the guarantees to the minorities. You may have a majority community, you may have a minority community. Both the communities you need to take into consideration. The views of both the communities you need to take into consideration. Every major decision has to go through a series of consultations. It cannot be, decisions cannot be one-sided of every one particular community. Now, every office bearer has certain rights and responsibilities which are assigned by the constitution and the law. Each of these, they are accountable not only to the people but also to the independent officials. Now, what does this tell you? This tells you that a democratic government rules within the limits set by the constitutional law and citizens' rights. Now, once again, let us try to review these four features of democracy. The first feature of democracy says that the final decision-making power must rest with those elected by the people. We saw in the case of Pakistan under General Pervez Musharraf, we cannot call it as a democratic government because people did not elect General Pervez Musharraf to power. He came to power because of the military coup which happened. He designated himself as the president, he granted himself an extension, and all the decision-making authority was in the hands of Pervez Musharraf but not in the hands of the people. In a democracy, what do we expect? The final decision-making should be, making power should be in the hands of those who are elected by the people. In the case of China, it was only the Communist Party which came into power. There was only a single party. They had a single party system. Unlike India, where we have multi-party system and any political party can come into power. So the second feature of democracy is where free and fair elections need to be held. If you take the case of Mexico, what did we see? Always it was the PRA which came into power. They used many fraudulent means to stay in power. This should not happen. In a democratic form of government, we expect that free and fair elections are held. Now, the third point is each adult citizen must have one vote and each vote must have one value. We are all given political rights. No matter, you may belong to a rich family, you may belong to a poor family, you may be a literate or you may be an illiterate, you may be employed or not, you may speak any language, you may belong to any religion, caste, color, whatever it is. But everybody should be treated equally in the eyes of law. And all those citizens, adult citizens, they must be having equal political rights. That is the third feature of democracy. Now, fourth point is a democratic government rules within the limits set by the constitutional law. The one is above the law. We saw in the case of Zimbabwe where the president amended the constitution to increase the powers. Isn't it such a thing? It shouldn't happen in a democracy. You should rule within the limits set by the constitution. And the rights of the citizen should not be denied. They should be given freedom to think, form opinion, protest if they don't like a particular policy. So today's discussion is based on, we started out with a simple definition of democracy. What is a simple definition? It is a form of government in which rulers are elected by the people. And these are the features of democracy. In the next module, we will see how we can differentiate democratic and non-democratic governments, what are the arguments which are against democracy and in favor of democracy, and we will try to understand the broader meaning of democracy. Thank you, children.